Hello, and welcome to the Canadian Coalition Against the Death Penalty's April Real Audio Report from here in Toronto, Canada. I'm Tracy Lamori.
And I'm Dave Parkinson. We begin with a special report on our recent meeting with representatives of the Italian Senate and Italy's ambassador to Canada.
Hands Off Cain, an influential Italian abolitionist group, has been working with the CCADP and the friends and supporters of Sebastian Burns and Atifa Faye, two young Canadian men currently in custody in British Columbia, Canada. Their fate currently rests in the hands of Canada's Supreme Court, who are going to decide whether they will be extradited to the U.S. to face capital charges and a possible death sentence if convicted.
Raffae and Burns maintain their innocence in the murder of Raffae's parents and 19-year-old sister. The Canadian police have used highly questionable tactics in their efforts to extract statements from the boys, who were only 18 at the time of the murders.
Amnesty International, as well as some well-known Canadian attorneys, are intervening in this case in an attempt to convince the Canadian government and courts to stand for justice and human rights and to not send these two young men to what we've already seen to be a corrupt justice system in the recent case of Albertan Stanley Falder, which has drawn international attention due to the U.S. once again violating the Vienna Convention.
The Vienna Convention is the international treaty meant to protect those who fall into police custody while in a foreign country. It allows the detained or arrested individual to immediately contact their consulate so that the visitor's home country is aware of their whereabouts and can ensure that they're treated fairly and afforded proper representation and a fair trial.
The U.S. frequently ignores this and other international conventions. For example, they execute juveniles and the mentally ill. We are asking Canadians to send a strong message to our government to not collude with the U.S. in state murder, especially when they've shown how little regard they have for law and justice. We encourage you to contact your local and federal representative, the Office of the Justice Minister, the Office of the Prime Minister, and your local media about this.
We here at the CCADP had been in contact with Hands Off Cain at the end of 1998, asking if there's any way that they could encourage the Italian government, who refuses to send prisoners to the U.S. for any reason, to intervene some way diplomatically with Canada and attempt to convince our government to keep Atifa Faye and Sebastian Burns in Canada. Hands Off Cain is affiliated with senators and the Italian Parliament, which has a committee that actively works on these issues.
Senators Cerami and Marchetti traveled to Canada the week of March 22nd. An important part of the visit involved meeting with the Office of the Justice Minister, specifically on the case of Burns and Raffae. They invited ourselves, Tracy Lamori and Dave Parkinson, co-founders and co-directors of the CCADP, to meet with the delegation and the ambassador, Roberto Nigido, at the Italian Embassy in Ottawa on Tuesday, March 23rd.
At the meeting, the senators questioned why Canada did not take a stronger stand for human rights when it comes to standing up to the U.S., making the point that they could be proud that such a small country as Italy stands firm to the U.S. in this area. They wondered whether Canada's proximity to the U.S. and their media was the reason.
On the topic of the occasional call, mostly from the Reform Party and other right-wing ideologues, for Canada to return to the death penalty, one of the senators said that would be a giant step backwards for the type of democracy that you've been able to create.
When we discussed the progress they'd made in discussing the extradition case with the Office of the Justice Minister, we were disturbed to hear that the Canadian government basically said they're not standing up against the extradition because they thought the Canadian people would support it. Don't allow the Canadian government to use you as an excuse to assist in the murder of our own citizens.
This is an emergency call to all you Canadians of conscience out there. Please do whatever you can to ensure that these two young Canadian citizens not be sent to the U.S. to possibly face the executioner if convicted. The Falder case has shown us that once in custody, the U.S. cannot be trusted to necessarily give a foreigner, or their own citizens for that matter, a fair trial. Ask your school, church, or community group to get involved. Write the Justice Minister, Anne McClelland, write the Prime Minister. Their address is on our homepage at www.ccadp.org. Scroll down to Sebastian Burns and Atifa Faye from the homepage. All the contact addresses and a lot more information on the case are there. We'd like to ask you to collect letters in your area, among your contacts, send them to the Minister's office, send them to the Office of the Prime Minister. No postage is necessary at all to send these to Ottawa from within Canada. We'd also like to ask you to contact any local representative as well as your local media about this case.
I would like to now move on to the Stanley Falder case and the Texas tourism boycott called for by the CCADP, and now joined by abolitionists, human rights groups, travel agencies, political parties, and student organizing groups worldwide. For those of you that are not familiar with the Stanley Fowler case, you can also see his webpage linked from www.ccadp.org for complete case info, amnesty alerts, and news reports. Fowler is the Canadian from Alberta who is currently residing on death row in Texas. He came very close to execution on December 10th, 1998. That was the 50th anniversary of the International Declaration of Human Rights. But he received a stay of execution at the last moment. Now the state of Texas has set a new execution date for June 17th, 1999.
Now, due to Texas once again violating the Vienna Convention in this case, due to the fact that Texas refuses to stop this execution, even though it was bought and paid for, prosecution and witnesses by the family of the victim, even though Canada did not know where this citizen was for almost 20 years, and also due to Texas' deplorable human rights record in this area, the CCADP called for an international tourist boycott of Texas.
And the boycott has received a lot of media attention, both here in Canada and as well in Texas. It's also made a few articles and reports in national U.S. media. Now, back in December, when the boycott was first made public, it was featured on TalkSpot International, Toronto's 640 AM, CBC Radio, National Public Radio in the U.S., the Toronto Star, Toronto Sun, National Post, both news agencies, Associated Press, and UPI. Even Memento from Quebec in French, the Austin American Statesman, World Socialist News, C Magazine from Alberta.
The story became big news again last week after Jerry Graham of the Longview, Texas News Journal did a telephone interview with us for an article that appeared on Sunday, 28th of March in that paper. That's the Longview, Texas News Journal. The next day, Monday the 29th, if you'd like to check your local newspaper archives, the story was picked up in a significantly altered form by the Associated Press and went out across North America. USA Today, CBC TV, CTV, CBC Radio, CHED Edmonton Radio, the Dallas Morning News, the Toronto, Ottawa, Edmonton, and Calgary Suns, the Montreal Gazette, the Ottawa Citizen, the Globe and Mail, as well as local papers across Canada and Texas.
Now, the interesting thing about all of this is the very important changes in the articles between the original Longview News Journal article, which we thought was well-reported and fair, but by the time it went out over the Associated Press wires, there was a major change. Now, in the initial story, a representative of the Texas Tourist Office, Tracy McDonald, says, "We know about the group, and we know about the website." Now, Associated Press says, "McDaniel said her department was not aware of the boycott, which is promoted on a website." Quite a difference. Possibly a little damage control there. Now, if you're interested in reading any of the news reports we've mentioned again, you can see them linked from our homepage at www.ccadp.org. You click on the CCADP in the news, and you can see all the reports there. Now, we're happy to report that the boycott has now spread. It's becoming very strong with lots of supporters in Europe, and they're helping us turn up the heat now on Texas. Just this week, there's been a strong initiative from Norway as well as from Italy, and they've been contacting Texas officials as well as Texas media with their support for the International Tourist Boycott of Texas. Now, following is a standard letter that some of the European groups are sending out to Texas officials and the media.
Greetings from whatever country. I guess you're wondering why you're getting mail from Europe today. Well, just to let you know that we are participating and supporting the International Tourist and More Boycott of Texas. As human beings, we feel deeply offended by what is happening in the United States of America, and especially Texas. Texas is the death penalty capital of the Western world. Texas has executed a shocking number of people since 1982, including some who were innocent. Texas has over 400 people who are currently on death row. Texas has a criminal justice system fraught with racism and with prosecutorial misconduct. Texas applies the death penalty in an arbitrary and a capricious manner. Texas executes its young, its mentally retarded, and its mentally ill. Texas discriminates against the poor by providing inadequate legal representation, poor social services, and a woeful lack of adequate educational opportunities. Texas has speeded up the execution process by limiting appeals, further eliminating assurances that the innocent will not be executed. Therefore, we will not spend our tourist money in Texas, and we will encourage family and friends all over the world not to do so. We will not embark on new activities in Texas. We will encourage business people, friends, and relatives here and abroad to avoid doing business with Texas. We will not attend conventions in Texas. Morally, socially, and economically, the death penalty is a bad public policy. There are alternatives to the death penalty. Please stop killing human beings.
Now, we hope that this boycott will have the effect of upping the level of discussion on the death penalty in the United States of America and making the populace there realize that the world views this as a serious human rights violation and not an issue of crime and punishment. We are asking America to stop the killing. If you or your group has not added your name and voice to the International Tourist Boycott of Texas, please do so now. Contact us by email at ccadp@home.com or by phone at 416-693-9112. Again, that's ccadp@home.com or by phone at 416-693-9112 to pledge your support. Now, this could be the most important international initiative against the death penalty ever. Let's hit them in the wallet. The tourist industry is huge in Texas, with many Canadian and European visitors. Spread the word. We can make a difference. For more information on the Texas tourism boycott, again, see the boycott link at CCADP's homepage at www.ccadp.org.
And now for a brief update on another important case the CCADP has been working on. The case of Jimmy Dennis, an innocent man on death row in Pennsylvania, has been garnering international attention. The story of this wrongful conviction has, in the last 6 months, appeared on radio here in Canada and in Germany and the Netherlands, magazines and newspapers in Germany, the Netherlands, Turkey, Italy, and on Dutch TV. People are speaking about him at churches and schools in Denmark, Italy, and the Netherlands, and more. Jimmy now has a strong network of supporters internationally, and there are web pages about him in many languages.
Now, we've all been working very hard in fundraising in order to afford Jimmy some real representation and investigation to clear his name and free him. Now, we're happy to report that thanks to everybody's efforts, Jimmy has just been able to retain an attorney. Now, our challenge now will be to raise $500 monthly to pay for his attorney and investigator. For more information on the case and what you can do to help, please see Jimmy's link from the CCADP page or from any search engine. Just type in Jimmy Dennis. His page includes a real audio message from Jimmy and all the information on his case. Again, Jimmy Dennis, type his name on any search engine and his page will come up, or link to him from the CCADP's homepage.
Many other inmates' web pages have been added recently, bringing the total number of CCADP inmate homepages now to over 50, with many coming. We also have over 250 death row inmate pen pal requests, many brand new, and many inmates are anxiously awaiting their first letters. If you can't personally take on an inmate pen pal right now, please direct others who may be interested to our pages. Again, that's at www.ccadp.org. If you're interested in helping transcribe any inmates' requests to go online, please email us to let us know. We can use all the help we can get in this regard. It is our intention to get every death row inmate who wants to be online up there.
And for those of you who may wish to join the CCADP, you don't have to be Canadian. If you support the work of the CCADP, please join us. Visit our webpage for membership information, which is available on a sliding scale from volunteer to corporate.
For those of you wishing to make a financial contribution towards the CCADP, we'll give you our information. The CCADP has no funding and operates out of the pockets of its members and volunteers. Your donation goes towards our internet access and pages, mailing expenses for us and to assist inmates, related long distance, calls from prisons to inmates' attorneys, families, and to media, office expenses, etc. To donate to the CCADP or to the Justice for Jimmy Defense Fund, send a check or an international money order to Canadian Coalition Against the Death Penalty, 80 Lillington Avenue, Toronto, Ontario, M1N3K7, Canada.
And again, all that information is on our webpage. If you need any more information about anything we've spoke to you about today, www.ccadp.org. We'd like to end today's program with an interview with Pat Rovensky. Now, Pat's a co-founder of the Canadian Coalition Against the Death Penalty. She spent a lot of time on the front line this year. She's been on 5 fact-finding missions to the Lone Star State of Texas since May of 1998. Her visits have included trips to consult with various members of the legal profession in Texas, families of inmates. She's also had a meeting with Randall Adams. He was an innocent man who was wrongfully convicted on Texas' death row, as well as many trips to Huntsville's notorious Ellis 1 unit, where they have the death house. Now, she's going to share with us a first-hand account of visits to Texas's death row, the procedure a visitor must go through, and her experiences with inmates, guards, and abolitionists, and prison administration. And Tracy's conducting the interview with Pat.
Hi, Pat. Thanks for sharing what you've learned on your many trips to Texas.
Hi.
First, maybe you can tell us what the general mood is in Texas relating to the death penalty. Like, what's the average person's thought? Is it something they think much about? Is it something that's just accepted? How do people feel?
Well, in the many times I've visited down there and I've spoken to many of the average citizens, they generally accept the death penalty as part of their life. They don't really think about it in their daily life. They go along and just live their own life, try and make a living, and they're not even aware of when there is an execution taking place. One thing I do find is that the Texans themselves are afraid to speak against the death penalty, say in their place of employment, for fear of being fired from their jobs, losing their jobs. And also, I find an unreasonably fear of the police on the streets. That's been my overall impression of the actual citizens of Texas.
The average person is afraid of the police on the streets.
Correct.
And, you know, talking a little bit about death row in Texas, Texas houses its male death row inmates at something called Ellis One Unit in Huntsville, prison town, USA. Where exactly is Huntsville? How easy is it to get to Huntsville? And maybe you can tell us a little bit about the prison industry in Huntsville.
Well, first of all, it is a procedure that you have to prepare for rather well in advance. Before you can actually go and visit, you have to be on the inmates' visitors list. Those people who live more than 250 miles away from Huntsville have to prepare by phoning the warden's office and booking special visits. You are allowed to have 2 days back-to-back, 4 hours a day per month. Now, those who live within the closer range are allowed one visit a week for 2 hours. Now, you fly into the Houston International Airport, and that is approximately 120 miles from Huntsville. So right off, you need to try and arrange transportation to Huntsville. A taxi actually costs you close to $200 one way.
Hmm.
Then you have to try and find accommodation in Huntsville. There are places to stay. There's motels. They run around $40 a night. Then you run into the problem of finding a ride from wherever you're staying to the prison itself, because it's fairly isolated. In fact, it's quite seductive in that the scenery around the prison, the prison itself is nestled amongst the most beautiful trees and forests and lakes. So you have no idea when you're driving around that this horrendous death house
mm-hmm.
is situated in the middle of this beautiful scenery.
And of course, so we at the CCADP recommend getting rides from friends wherever you can and staying with friends whenever you're in Texas and whenever possible so as to not contribute to the Texas economy whenever we can avoid it.
Correct. And there are many people that do put you up. There are many Texans that are kind enough to give you a ride up to Huntsville, to accommodate you in their homes, to try and give you rides to the prison wherever they can, insofar as that they live in their daily lives as well,
mm-hmm.
and they try and accommodate you.
Can you tell us a little bit about what procedure a visitor actually experiences when you do get to the point of visiting an inmate at Huntsville?
Okay, you're driving along and through this forest, and you see the most beautiful greenery, and then you see that lake, and then all of a sudden there's a turn, and you turn right, and that's where you actually stop and see that this is now totally different. First of all, there is a guard at a gate, and they stop the car. You have to release the hood and the trunk, and the guard takes the license number of the driver, asks who the inmate is that you are visiting, checks everybody's ID. Now, if you come in from overseas, you have to produce your passport and your airline ticket. Otherwise, they will not let you in. Then, when the guard feels that, you're not bringing in any kind of contraband, they wave you through, and you have to drive very slowly up, and then you start seeing the brick buildings, all the wire that surrounds it, and you then reach a gatehouse where you again go in, and they take down your name, and they check to see who you're visiting, and then they make a phone call to someone inside the prison to get the prisoner ready to bring him to the visiting room. Now, you have to actually get there fairly early, because if you're not there by 7:30 in the morning, the chances are that for the rest of the day, you're going to be waiting, because they only have a certain amount of cages, and each cage will be occupied for 4 hours. So it's important to get there early.
To miss your visit.
And sometimes you wait an hour before they even bring the inmate to you. So there's once you've been cleared, they then wand you. They said put a wand, you know, like an airport, and they wand you to make sure that you don't have anything on you. You are permitted to bring $10 to purchase a drink or something to eat for the inmate at the vending machine.
And the inmate's behind glass? Or?
Well, the inmates are brought in, and they're handcuffed. And then there is this cage, and they put into the cage, and then there's this little slot at the back where they have to put their hands behind their back. Obviously, they're handcuffed behind their back. And they put their hands through the slot, and the guard will then release the handcuffs, and they are then locked into this cage, and they spend the 4 hours in this cage. And with the visitor, you're speaking to them through plexiglass and also mesh. So it's not very easy to hear each other talk.
And there's no contact visits at all?
No, not at all. And I have to say that I personally have not experienced this, but other friends have, and I hope I never have to experience this. But when there is a man who's going to be executed, he is then allowed visitors from 8 that morning to 1 o'clock, and he is brought into the same area where all the other visitors are. And so you have a situation where you are sitting visiting your friend, and right next to you will be the man who will be executed within a few hours, and he has his family, his parents, his brothers, his sisters, and they're all crying, and they're all saying their final goodbyes to him. Very, very difficult to visit under those circumstances. And then the inmate who is scheduled for execution that night is taken away. So that certainly is not something that is it is pleasurable to watch.
No, and I'm sure it has quite an effect on other inmates when there are executions.
Right. The inmates feel it, the visitors feel it, and most certainly the man who's going to be executed and his loved ones feel it.
Mm-hmm. What has generally been your impression of the guards in the prison administration?
Well, it all depends on whether the guards are having a good day or not. So you have to release your passport and your airline ticket to the reception area. They hold on to that for you. And then generally it still takes another, you know, sometimes 30 minutes before they bring the inmate. And sometimes they're very friendly and other times they're very surly. It depends, I guess, on whether they're having a good day or not. They treat this as a job. They are there at 8 o'clock, and they want to leave at 5, and they don't want anything to disrupt their lives. And then you have the guards who are behind the cages, and they are walking up and down, and normally what their job is to make sure that you don't get a minute over 4 hours. Or when you've bought your friend something to eat or something to drink, there's a little, like a little hatch door that you put it there, and then they'll go and take it and disperse it to the inmate. So that's their job. And normally, if they're in a good mood, they will knock on the cage and say, you've got 5 minutes. Or if they are not having a good day, they'll just come and say, time's up. Mm-hmm. So you don't have a chance to say goodbye. And then you have to leave. And many a time, because they don't seem to have enough staff, they're not realizing that at the end of the month that there are more visitors, especially from Europe and Canada, more visitors, therefore they need more staff. So the inmates actually sometimes sit in the cages waiting an hour, hour and a half to be taken back to their cells. They particularly don't like this, because this gives the guards an opportunity to go into their cells, and normally what they do is trash the cells. They start throwing everything upside down. Sometimes they've lost their legal materials or their precious family photographs, mm-hmm. and that type of thing, which is totally unnecessary. Yeah. And that's the extent. And you leave, and you kind of leave with a really an emotional, heavy heart, to think that there is a human being who is being treated in that manner. You know, so you leave, and it's extremely emotional, and then you have to get back to to wherever you're staying for the day.
Back to normal so-called life,
right.
Meeting them there, yeah. Just briefly, for our listeners who may not be familiar with some of the stories of Texas justice or injustice, you've met with Randall Adams in one of your visits to Texas.
Correct.
The story of Randall Adams is a case in point of Texas justice. Tell us a little bit about his case.
When I went down to Houston in May already of 98, there was the Journey of Hope was going through, and they had invited Randall Adams to be a guest during the Journey of Hope through Texas. He was fairly reluctant to return to Texas, for obvious reasons. He had been accused of murder of a police officer, and he had been on Texas death row for, I believe, approximately 9 years. At one point, he was 72 hours away from execution, and then his family somehow managed to find the money, and that's what it's all about, is money, to retain a competent attorney,
mm-hmm.
who then finally proved his innocence, and he was then released. However, it took nearly 2 years to get him released.
And he was basically lucky. I mean, I'm sure there's many cases on Texas death row as well as around the U.S., of guys just languishing on death row, and I'm sure some have been executed who weren't able to get that together, which sort of leads us into another question I'd like to ask you, which is, we've been speaking with a lot of attorneys in Texas, both court-appointed as well as hired attorneys, and I'd be interested in hearing, and I'm sure people would be interested in hearing your viewpoints, your experience with attorneys in Texas.
Well, my experience with the court-appointed attorneys are that they are usually not that interested in representing the client to the best of their ability, whether they have the qualifications or not. I cannot judge on that aspect of it, but I do know that every single person, inmate, who has had a court-appointed attorney has ended up on death row. Those who have been lucky enough to retain counsel and actually have the funds to pay have been given, a fair deal, and have been given a fair trial. You have to remember that with a court-appointed attorney, he's being paid by the state, and he's not being paid that well. He doesn't have the funds, or very little funds, for, say, an investigator. He has maybe no funds, perhaps, very little funds, for, say, forensic experts. So what the jury is getting is just the one side, which is the prosecutor's side.
Mm-hmm.
There is no one there objecting to what the prosecutor is presenting to the jury. So the old adage that, you know, money talks is very much true in the Texas justice system.
Well, like there was an inmate who was killed by the state in the 70s, and he said, capital punishment, those without the capital get the punishment, and that's so true.
That's very true.
And maybe also you can tell us a little bit about, this sort of goes in with your experience with attorneys. You've been working on the Charles Raby Legal Defense Fund down in Texas.
Correct.
I know he's an inmate at Huntsville. If you could tell us a little bit about the defense fund and how people might be able to help out and where they could get some information if they're interested.
Well, in the case of Charles Raby, there is a great need for a legal defense fund. It's quite possible that if people do donate and we do have a sufficient amount of funds, that he could get a new hearing. And there is a bank account which is called the Charles Raby Defense Fund. That is at the Royal Bank of Canada on Avenue Road in Lawrence at 1500 Avenue Road in Toronto. And the account number is 400-2002. For more information, you'll be able to find the complete information on that account on the CCADP website.
Again, that's www.ccadp.org.
Correct.
And we'll give you that Charles Raby Defense Fund address again at the end of the broadcast. And we do encourage people to help out. This is the first case the CCADP worked on, and we'd really like to see some donations come in for that.
That's correct. It would be very much appreciated, considering that I've spent so much time down in Texas. I have had numerous interviews with attorneys. I'm sad to say that even though these attorneys did give me their time and did read some of his transcripts, told me that it was very possible he could have a new hearing. It was all about money,
mm-hmm.
all about money. And I would hate to think that just because the funds are not there is that he would be executed.
So again, that address is the Charles Raby Defense Fund. That's Charles Raby, R-A-B-Y, Defense Fund at the Royal Bank of Canada. Checks or international money order, you can, I believe it's a bank transfer you can make, or
correct,
mail a check. And that's Royal Bank of Canada at the Avenue Road and Lawrence branch at 1500 Avenue Road, Toronto, Ontario, M5M3X2. That's Mary 5 Mary 3 X-ray 2. And the account number on that is 400-2002.
Correct.
And I believe you want to give your email contact if anybody has email access and would like more information on the case or to speak with Patricia. What's that email, Pat?
My email, you can email me at patricia@ccadp.org.
And so if anybody would like some more information or to speak with Pat about that.
Sure.
Thanks very much for speaking with us today, Pat, and your experiences down in Texas are very valuable and very interesting. And we'll I understand you're going back there in another 2 weeks?
I am. I'm going back there to confer with more attorneys.
Okay. And, best of luck. And, again, we ask everybody to contribute to the Charles Raby Defense Fund.
Correct.
Thanks so much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.